resistance or argument, and so I don't quite know what they're going on about. But it's also sort of curiously personal, and I want to understand it. I mean, I don't care what people say, but I'd rather understand the argument. I mean, I thought that it would be a brilliant idea if you actually heard what my views are and my policies and my ideas from me before slamming me for what I don't think and am not doing for motives I don't possess. And if you had just ever, any of you, any of your staff had ever bothered to ask me what I think and what I'm doing and why, then you could attack me even better. But what I'm sorry, what is the position I'm taking? How would you define it? Good. I look forward to it.
Just briefly, the article.
It's from next editor. Next editor is
Peter!
Yeah, I'm just here, Richard. Right.
P. Why is this thing I've written here being crossed out?
Because it was undecipherable. And we thought fair was a better expression.
Thank God, what I want. Thank you.
But can you tell us precisely what it is?
But, that's spelled B-U-T. Not, that's N-O-T.
Okay.
More, that's M-O-R-E. Of, I think that's fairly clear, of, O-F. It's, that's I-T-S.
Okay, let's read the entire sentence.
Share.
Who's going to be doing your biography, do you think?
I don't know. Perhaps if I have enough time on my hands.
Are you going to write one?
I don't know.
Everyone else does.
Yeah. We were in a place 6 months ago where, you know, quite honestly, the uphill struggle was too great. The mountain too big to climb, that's what I knew. But now, it's amazing how things change. It's much more fluid. It's fluid, of course, because of, not really because of us, but because of the Tories. The public are taking a longer look at them, and for the first time the Tories are coming under some sort of scrutiny. And they hate it, of course. Wondered what's hit them, that somebody might actually ask what they would do if they were elected. This has come as a great shock to them, these people who exude such a sort of sense of entitlement. You know, they're coming across as a couple of flaky schoolboys. I mean, they grab every passing headline. They're like a couple of schoolboys running into the sweet shop, putting their hands in every jar, stuffing their pockets, you know, without any sense of discrimination or judgment, and then they sort of rush to the counter. And not only are they completely unaware of the consequences of stuffing themselves with all these sweets, but then they find they can't even pay for them either. It's a sort of, you know, that is what I think people are beginning to feel about them. And Cameron has invested his own authority and his own credibility in Osborne. He is the weakest link. He may not be so weak that he stops them being elected. That's only time will tell. But he's certainly too weak to be a strong chancellor. Now, hold on, Marie. I'm going to Nottingham tomorrow, yeah?
Yeah. The reception tomorrow night, and then.
How annoying.
Is there anything you wanted to do on Friday specifically?
I want to work. I want it to be my time, my thinking time, my thinking time, my work.
Thank you.
Thanks. days later. And I think it would have been more honest, more straightforward and straight dealing with the company and its workforce, and also with the government, if she had told me what their intentions were.
Where's Jeffrey?
He's having a meeting about budget.
Is it? Okay. Measures.
The Prime Minister wants to talk about the economy. Let me give him one statistic and see if he will confirm it. Figures out today show that GDP per capita is lower today than when this government began. Will he confirm this is the first government in 40 years to leave this country poorer than when it began?
Well, it would be worrying if it were true. I mean, we're not closing down universities or campuses or courses or whatever. The problem with the Northeast media, oftentimes, I said it all the time when I was Member of Parliament for Hartlepool, is that you are a constant stream of demoralising news for the Northeast. You never stop talking down the region. Now, what you've got to do, of course, is paint an accurate picture of what's happening, and it's your job to point up the problems and challenges that the region faces. But could you also, as a BBC and other local media, point to the good news, the creation of new businesses? I'm not asking you to put a positive spin on anything. I'm not asking you to spin anything. What I'm trying to say to you is that businesses will come and businesses will go. That's in the nature of our economy, especially given the sort of global recession we've gone through. And what I'm saying to you is that businesses come, they start up, they grow as well. They're so woefully ignorant. These people who sit in BBC radio studios, they have no idea what is happening beyond their own building. I remember Tony once saying, you know, you've got to stop acting, he said, in such a sort of imperial way. And what he meant by that was, you know, you're very tough with people, you're very sort of sure of yourself, you're a bit sort of categorical and a bit, this must be done in the way that I want at the time of my choosing. You've just got to handle people a bit more, you know. And that was... probably right, he was a very good observer of me, but that was partly because I had gone through the 80s and the 90s trying to change the bloody Labour Party. And I was very impatient, it's absolutely true, but the other thing was that I felt a sense of power, and I think I showed it too much. That's, I think, what he meant. Neil Kinnock saying at the end of the 80s, early 90s, people who say that Peter Mandelson is Labour's evil genius are only half right.
Do you remember who said he's a curious mixture of geniality and venom?
No, geniality and venom. No, who was it?
That was Churchill on your grandfather.
Oh, really? My grandfather believed very deeply that the Labour Party was a national party or it was nothing, that we weren't a sectional party of the trade unions. He didn't want to cut our links with the trade unions, but he certainly didn't want to be pushed around by them, and he certainly didn't want people to feel that the only thing we stood for was what the trade unions wanted that day.
I personally have always thought that there was no necessary antagonism between Labour and what are known as the middle classes.
How did New Labour come about? What was
New Labour finally came about when Tony Blair made it come about, but the roots of it were in the 1980s, after the 83 election. Absolute disaster. We nearly went down the plug hole in the 83 general election. We stabilised, Neil Kinnock became leader, and he embarked with a team around him, of whom I was one, to rescue the Labour Party from oblivion, to drive out the ultra-left and the militant entryists, and then to start to deal with some of our more extreme vote-losing policies. And it was hard-fought. I mean, it was hand-to-hand combat. I mean, I felt in particular I was helping him fight in the jungle against people in our own party who were trying to consign us to oblivion, whilst at the same time as the communications director fighting the media and taking on the press.
I think for too long the Labour Party has viewed television as our persecutor. Well, I want to use television as our tool, as our servant, and we shall be presenting ourselves and putting across our policies and making sure that our spokesmen get the coverage so that they can communicate directly with the people.
What was the moment that you realised that it would have to be Tony Rutherford at that moment?
I didn't really decide. I didn't make the call. Others did. When John died, the party, in opinion amongst Labour MPs and the trade unions, just went to Tony. I mean, like, whoosh, like that. I mean, it happened within 24, 48 hours. And Gordon realised it. It's just coming to terms with it and adjusting to it. It was very hard and very painful, and then easing himself out of the race to allow Tony to go forward created a real amount of pain, I mean, both for him and his supporters. They couldn't look at Gordon and ask themselves why he wasn't favoured over Tony. It had to be because somebody did this to him, and I was the instrument of choice.
Sleeping good, bye.
That's great. Let's have a quick look.
That's good. What about looking out the window?
No, that's really weird. It looks as if my head has been grafted onto something else. That's look. Much better.
So some of the early ones from that setup, because I went wider, the lens. Go back one. So I think that's really nice.
I think they're good, huh? No, I don't like my mouth. My mouth looks old there. Still.
Come on, that's it.
Okay.
Okay, let's go.
Just sort of tell me, what is your SWOT analysis? Strengths.
Well, it's all threats and no it's all threats and no opportunities. Yeah, I mean, look, the biggest I think the biggest single thing we have to focus on, which obviously relates to the budget, is how do we demonstrate that this manifesto is a fiscally credible package, which, you know, points the way to a sort of credible, you know, next term for the Labour Party. I mean, I think the danger, you know, as we've seen before, is that it looks like a set of spewed-out, uncosted commitments that don't add up.
I mean, it would be very hard to stop everyone piling everything into it by the kitchen sink.
Can we do more than high-speed rail, you know, growth and social care? Personally, I think we're in a real mess on social care, but we've now discovered that we need £1.5 billion to fund the next parliament, but we've discovered since a £3.8 billion black hole in the funding for maintaining the current level of social care provision.
Okay, that's very unfortunate.
Yes, current provision and the bill's proposals and what we'd want to do in the next parliament would cost in total £5.2 billion. So it would be 3.8 plus 1.5.
Sorry, it would be about £5
billion? £5.2 billion, yeah.
The Prime Minister's supporters rushed to deny allegations about his behaviour towards his staff. A new book details a series of alleged black moods and angry outbursts, from shoving aside an aide to crashing his fist into the back of a car seat.
He hasn't hit you? He hasn't shouted at you?
Hit me?
Yeah. Metaphorically or physically?
I don't know either.
Well, I think history records we've had our moments.